trend in film production has compressed a lot in terms of the pre-production period. Someone like Ridley, who's basically shooting multi-camera setups, getting all of his shots in much fewer takes, is the only way to meet these schedules.
There really are, you know, sort of three sections of the movie in a way. There's Earth, there's the ship, the Hermes, and there's Mars.
There's the NASA segment on locations in and around Budapest, and stage work here with regard to the habitat and the surface work, which will extend to Jordan landscapes. And then the mothership, the Hermes, which will be mostly on sets, on other stages, and in visual effects exteriors around the cosmos.
When we started to prep this film, it was already quite busy in Budapest. We would have hoped to have crewed more locally, and saying that, I'm sure we're running at over 500 local crew, but you know, we've probably imported about 140 to work here.
This is our mission control set, NASA 10 years from now. We're here in Budapest in the CET complex, better known as the Whale Building. This is just an unbelievably sophisticated structure of an enormous scale with automatic louvered windows that can be adjusted to certain angles in relation to the sunlight. You've got a geodesic structure from which we can hang. You can see the enormous screens behind me. They're incredibly heavy, and we had to haul them up on winches.
The screens are like 100 feet tall, and so seeing the visuals while you're doing the scene, it creates this really potent experience. They put so much care and detail into everything in the set, like all the papers on the desk. I always, on every set, investigate what like each workstation has to see if it's true or if it's just one paper on top that has text and everything else is blank. And everything on every desk was specific to that desk. It was just such a level of detail I hadn't experienced before.
This building gives us a whole other group of areas on three different levels. We're doing a press room, we're doing the main entry, we're doing several characters' offices, we're doing a huge conference room. So this is a complex of composite sets.
Green screen is, of course, essential in this. And in fact, the big stage at in Budapest was 65 feet high and 360 around on a stage that's bigger than Bond.
We'd made the decision that we wanted to build everything as much as possible. We couldn't build space, but we could build all the ships and hab and everything else in the movie. And so we needed something that could house those kinds of sets.
It was a brand new green screen, so it was a perfect way of matching whatever I have on location to put onto the set. But on the set, I've already built absolute landscape of with the undulations of the real desert in Wadi Rum. I copied it because I went there and photographed it. And I've built a matching double of the habitat, which will be in exactly this position in relation to the rocks in Wadi Rum. So it becomes a jigsaw puzzle of matching the absolutes of what you're photographing.
Especially on big green screen stages where you've only got a small amount of a practical set piece or an actor, you're constantly thinking about all the things that will be there later and making sure all the relationships bear out, getting the correct camera angles for what you need. We employ a device called Simulcam, supplied by Third Floor, and it allows us to live comp the background of the shot into what we're shooting on green screen. And that gives Ridley good framing, it gives editorial a reference for what we're shooting, so we don't end up with sort of weird stuff in the cut.
The biggest challenge was matching what we're going to do on stage with what's in here. I mean, it's really hard to reproduce this stuff, you know. But we were lucky in Budapest, we had a very big stage. So you basically use one source light pretending it's the sun, and we kept it as far away and as high, just to basically make the light as naturalistic as possible.
Potatoes are like bananas, pulses, beans. You could live on banana, you can live on a coconut, and you can live on a potato.
Anybody knows the actual Latin name for a potato?
Mm-hmm.
Find out.
We can Google it.
Solanum tuberosum.
Very good. Here we go.
Okay, let's do it, please. Here we go.
Solanum tuberosum. That's the weirdest line I've ever had to say in a movie.
We're in the Hab set. This is where Mark Watney lives and grows his potatoes to survive on Mars. As you can see, I'm surrounded by potato plants and a lot of Martian soil. The potatoes we've been growing for 3 months now.
It's like walking into a marijuana factory, because I'd go in this room, there's all these daylight things, and it's like you switch the lights off quick, it's marijuana. And we had a potato farm in a long drawing office. And I mean, growing through the winter in Budapest in January, Christmas to January, and I had my trusty gardener there who does everything.
To construct the set, you see, we brought in the soil first. It's a normal soil that you'll see out being used for the Martian landscape. The potatoes are all grown in bags for ease. These plastic bags can come in here. We roll them down and then cover them with soil. The difficulty here, because the potatoes have been grown in virtually a sterile environment where they've had all their own light, heat, fertilizers and waters. Of course, they've kind of come out of the nursery, and we've had to create that. Every evening, the lights are brought back in here. The potatoes are heated and lit.
This is potato porn.
This is what Mark would have done to grow his potatoes. No different to what we've actually done. He, as a character, and we as a department have grown them for real. There's no artificial potatoes here at all.
Well done, gentlemen. Well done.
My favorite part has just been working with Ridley. That was really why I signed up, ultimately. And it's fun to work with master directors who've been doing this a really long time, who know what they want. It's just every day is fun. We get our work done. We get our work done relatively quickly. Everyone's prepared. It's how you should make movies.
The reason I like to build as much set as possible is for the benefit of the actor. I try and really put as much up there for them as I possibly can, and also much of the proscenium, i.e. the sets and the environment, as I can to help them.
When things are really happening practically around you, no acting required. You just are the character in that situation, and the truth comes out. You know, versus being surrounded in a green screen where you're having to basically imagine a whole environment.
All of the stuff on the ship is practical, and it makes such a difference. Actually having the levers to push myself through when I'm floating through, and sitting at the bridge commanding the mission when we're going back, and having all the buttons to push, and just makes my job easier.
That really wants to make things look real and feel real. It's a tremendous difference.
He's like, strap in, and then he doesn't, you know, we're not there for a long time, and even if we are, he doesn't tell us.
Here we go. Ready? And action.
One scene where we're sitting in the chairs before we launch, suddenly I hear, okay, chairs down. And I said, what, chairs down? And suddenly the chair goes down. I was like, really? No, this is not happening. And then, like, without telling us, really just went, okay, they're launching. And the whole thing, like, went off like I was in a theme park.
You can't fake that reaction. You know, like if you know what's happening, or if you're like pretending to, you know? And that's why he shoots with four cameras, five, six cameras sometimes, and then make sure that he gets a close-up and a medium on everyone.
We can't shoot the entire film on stages, so it was looking to where can we basically recreate the wider planet surface. We looked extensively, and we've settled in Wadi Rum in Jordan, which we have shot before on Prometheus, so we know the location.
On this one, I thought, better go back and shoot there on the ground, because it's still one of the most remarkable deserts I've ever seen.
We are in the south of Jordan. Wadi Rum is called the Valley of the Moon. Wadi Rum changes colors by the movement of the sun.
If you pass by a location and then a couple of hours you come back, it looks completely different.
We're filming in a UNESCO World Heritage Site, and for that, various permits and permissions need to be sought. There's next to no infrastructure, so everything you bring here, you've got to bring yourself. Whilst you're looking at me, and behind me is no doubt great big huge vistas, if you happen to spin the camera through 180 degrees, there's about 55 pickups, trucks, tents, mobile loos, 50-foot super techno cranes, we've got army vehicles, you name it. Basically to allow everybody here to have a cold bottle of water, have their food, get the actors on set, make sure the cameras work, and indeed our director's sitting in an air-conditioned easier.
This is the hab, so this is hab number two, because we built exactly the same set on stage in Budapest, which we've shot a huge amount of the scene. We're now shooting all the big, wide exteriors.
The environment here has got a lot of desert-type plants, which we weren't allowed to remove. For the first job was organising with the National Park people what we could and couldn't do. We were allowed to cut down the plants probably by about a third. Then we covered them with a canvas material, painted a sand colour, and then dressed on top of that sand, rocks, to make them merge in with the landscape that was already here. In and around the hab, we had to recreate post-storm on Mars, so we drifted lots and lots of sand up against the hab, and generally, as I said, recreated the situation we had back in Corner Studios.
It's about 30 feet to the actual
map. We're moving location to location here within the park, so, you know, none of it is on tarmac roads. A lot of it's not on any roads whatsoever. So everything is having to be four-wheel drive, six-wheel drive, to the top of massive sand dunes and hillsides in the middle of nowhere.
When you've got a total of seven cameras and four camera teams and a helicopter unit and then Ridley Scott directing, it's a large beast to try and, well, you don't try and control it, but you try and manage it.
At the end of the day, we work fast. Ridley works fast. He works with many cameras. So if you're moving that quick, you've got to be ready for the next setup. So you've got to have all of your gear in the right place at the right time.
Vincent, that's straight ahead, straight ahead.
We've been building these rovers to work here, really, to get these rovers good enough to drive over anything that Ridley wants it to in the desert. Got it out on the sand, and it went like a dream. Anything Ridley wanted it to do, it's done. And more, and we were lucky enough to be driving it for all the aerial shots. We drove up and over sand dunes and along ridges and all sorts of stuff, and it didn't get stuck, it just flew over everything.
Check the gate.
Matt Damon has had some driving lessons, and I've been in the cab with him, helping him, you know, pick his route. We did some great stuff driving along the side of a sand dune and slipping and purposely getting it stuck, and I was operating the oil and guiding him into giving it, well, so give it full revs, you know, go on, you know, all that kind of stuff. He loved it.
Cheers, mate.
It's great to finish the film on a location like this where everybody is just wowed by it, you know, and also they're going to see this is having shot many scenes in a green screen environment on stage in Hungary, to come out here and be in the real environment. It's got everybody in great form to finish the film.